Part 3 of this series has to do with solvency and profitability ratios. First, a word about solvency or leverage ratios. Leverage is using a small amount of effort or force and obtaining a big result, like we see in this little guy using leverage to move a huge stone. Leverage in business is basically the use of debt to finance all or part of the business. Leverage multiplies the results. So with more leverage, earnings are multiplied for a greater return to the shareholders. Remember, the goal of a business is to maximize the equity value for the shareholders, or in the case of a public company, the share price. And increasing the return to shareholders will do this. However, the use of debt increases risk. So I have the symbol of a scale. We have to balance the risk and the reward. Because when times are bad and there's a loss, leverage caused by debt will also multiply the loss. So there always needs to be this balance between risk and reward. The first long-term solvency, or leverage ratio, is the debt ratio and helps answer the question, can the company meet its obligations over the long term? The debt ratio helps answer the question, how much debt is being used to support the business versus shareholders' equity, or what I like to think of as other people's money. The debt ratio is total liabilities divided by total assets. And I calculated these ratios from the latest year-end reports. Microsoft has a debt ratio of 0.45. Apple at 9/29/12 had a debt ratio of 0.33, or 33%. That means that a third of Apple's assets were financed by debt, and about two-thirds were financed by equity. The higher the ratio, the more the risk. So Microsoft has a greater debt ratio and thus a little bit more risk than Apple. Okay, is this good or bad? Well, use of debt can be good because it magnifies the return to shareholders. I find both 0.45 and 0.33, you know, in a very conservative and good range for technology companies. This ratio will vary greatly between industries. Technology companies can be riskier than other types of companies such as utilities, and investors, or actually banks and bondholders, are more reluctant to lend to technology companies. So you will see less debt. Take a look at Boeing as of their last financial statement on 12/31/12. They have a debt ratio of 0.93, or 93%. That means that 93% of their assets are financed by debt. This is a very high ratio. And this is one reason, even though Boeing has great returns to the shareholders, I consider it risky, and I would not want to invest in Boeing. Who uses this ratio? Basically, long-term lenders, such as banks and bondholders. Investors use it to assess risk as well. Another long-term solvency ratio, which I indicate is new because it's not in your book, is the debt-to-equity ratio. And this measures a similar thing, how much debt the company is using compared to the shareholders' equity. We take total liabilities divided by total owner's equity. I got these ratios from Reuters. I indicated that this is an MRQ, which means calculated for the most recent quarter. Again, we see Microsoft at 19.76 and Apple at 13.75. My calculations based on the balance sheets are different, but you can use this as a relative gauge of leverage. So we see again consistent with our calculations, that Microsoft is more leveraged than Apple. Looking at Boeing, shows a ratio of 127.27. Again, very high. Fastenal, a company we saw a ratio before, conservative company with a very high current ratio, they show a total debt to equity ratio of zero. Very little debt used, very little leverage, very conservative. This is a case of apples to oranges. You cannot compare the total debt to equity ratio with the total debt ratio that you calculated. They are entirely different, although they do give you an indication about the same thing. But this is the one that's publicly available up on Reuters. The third leverage ratio is times interest earned. And this is kind of a safety measure. This measures how many times could the interest expense be paid out of earnings before interest and taxes, before basically running out of money. As of 9/30/13, neither Microsoft or Apple reported, so we just saw these dashes at Reuters. I look at that as meaning that they have offset the interest expense with interest income or earnings from short-term investments, therefore measuring interest expense at zero. So they're not reported, okay? I took a look at Boeing. Boeing had a ratio of 25.19, which meant that Boeing could pay its interest 25 times before running out of earnings before interest and tax to pay interest. I put a little exclamation mark down here at the lower left-hand corner, because in this case, the higher the ratio means the less risk, the lower the ratio means more risk. In other words, lenders want to see the ability to pay the interest as many times over as possible. Profitability ratios give us an indication of how well has the company performed overall. And these are all very important ratios to management, investors, banks, and analysts, basically to everyone. First, the profit margin shows the amount of profit earned from sales and other operations. Very dependent on the industry. I've shown Microsoft and Apple pretty high profit margins, with Microsoft at 28 versus Apple at 22. Microsoft's is higher, it's better. You would see a profit margin, if you thought of just the grocery part of a grocery, the profit margins there are pretty slim, maybe 2%, maybe 5%. So it really depends on the industry. Okay. As another example, Boeing, a manufacturer, most recently of the Dreamliner, profit margin of about 5, so substantially different than Microsoft and Apple, these technology companies. Another very important profitability ratio is return on assets. That is the amount of profit earned on each dollar invested in assets, and it measures management's efficiency at using its assets. So, net profit after taxes divided by total assets. Return on investment for Microsoft, 16.58. Apple, 20.81. So the return on assets is better for Apple than on Microsoft. The higher the ratio, the better. Again, used by many types of users. Boeing, as a side note, has a return on assets of 4.84%, and this is given as a percent. So I'm going to go back in and put percent signs in here. Apple's ratio of 20.81% means that for every $100 invested in assets, they're earning $20 net profit after taxes. Return on equity. It's the amount of profit earned on each dollar invested by the shareholders. Again, the result is a percentage. So Microsoft, for every $100 invested, is earning $30 net profit. Apple, $32. So Apple has a higher return on equity than Microsoft. Boeing, because of its leverage, has a 63% return on equity. Even though the profit margin was lower, the return on assets was lower, because of that leverage, they have driven up their return on equity. Who uses this? Again, management, investors, banks, analysts, but for an investor, return on equity, or return on their investment, is a very important ratio.